back, WNST, Towson, Baltimore, and Baltimore Positive. This is going to be a fun one here. Summer months, and somehow the hockey game's on. And when I think of hockey, I think of Phil Jackman and my dear friend at the Evening Sun. And you know, Father's Day going the other day, I am friends with all of the Jackman daughters, even though, you know, everybody knows I had the crush on Susan. I've always admitted this, but Michele is here. Michele Jackman Anthony, she is a frequent visitor here as executive director of the National Kidney Foundation, even though she's gone to the dark side and become a Washington Nationals fan. We do welcome her back on. They have a golf tournament coming up. I just love all of the Jackmans. Don't tell anyone, but Tina's probably my favorite. She was always nicer to me than Phil or any of the daughters for that matter. But okay, you now, would admit your mother's the nicer.
Better than me. Susan's better than me. Why am I coming back on your show?
No. Hold on. Your mother's the nicest one. You would admit that.
Yes, of course.
Well, I mean, they're all...
She is mother to all of Baltimore.
They are hardened New England people who made their way with these three beautiful daughters, with people like me trying, you know, running around the world, and like your hardened Long Island background, and your sister works in the tough COVID things of Los Angeles. Right, I mean, your mom is still like the nice realtor who sold me this place that I'm trying to sell now.
Yep. She sure is. Nothing much changes in the family. She's been in that field for ever. After the Pairing Racket Club, of course, where she was, you know, there for many, many years as well.
Well, you put
and
up
Susan's
great
still
picture.
Working in the COVID ward at Cedars-Sinai. She's one of those frontline workers.
On Father's Day. And it was it was Phil era, Phil, like running track and coaching track. And then I came into your life right around there. When was that picture taken with Sheila?
That was 1985. That was me and my dad dancing at Sheila and Eric's wedding.
Okay. So I came into your dad's life six months later.
Oh, you did?
1986, yes.
You remember?
You wanted me to tell some Phil stories in this thing for Father's
Definitely
Day.
Definitely tell some Phil stories.
So I have to tell you this. Phil was very, very skeptical of me.
He was skeptical of me.
Yeah, you know, Phil was very, and this is before I knew he had daughters or anything. Yeah, I mean, I read your dad's columns for years. He was the cantankerous, you know, Oreo guy from out of town. He did the scores on Saturday night at WMAR. And so, you know, and he was the guy that always had the funny New England accent. He worked with Bill Burton, you know, with the fish on TV on the screen. Of all the places I'm going to be going in the state, I'm going to honor Bill Burton when I'm in Cambridge. So yeah. Your dad came into my life because, like, he was the hockey guy. He didn't look like the picture in the paper. Like the old cartoon. When I actually met him, I didn't know it was Phil Jackman. Like, it was weird to me.
Oh, the cartoon. I remember those. Yeah,
it was like a black and white pencil sketch of Phil, right? It didn't really look like Phil. Like, the thing I saw in the Evening Sun at my grandfather's house in Randallstown that was his picture, well, it didn't look like. He was younger. He was much younger, and he looked like the picture that you put up. He looked like this younger guy. He always looked like an old curmudgeon fart in the paper in black and white when I was a kid, you know? So I had no idea he was like this athletic, you know, fun guy, right? So your dad was always skeptical of me, but he knew I liked hockey, and he knew my last name. And I think my cousin was an asshole to him, because he probably was an asshole to every – they were athletes. So your dad had guys that when I got to know your father really well, really well, I knew what players he liked and what guys were – that guy was a jackass. He was hushy. So I got to learn all of this from your dad. So I think Louis probably wasn't nice to any of the reporters, probably, you know, as I've learned this as a hardened 52-year-old reporter myself. So your dad had favorites and people that he liked and stuff. So I probably had already that strike against me. I was from the News American. He was always skeptical of anybody from the News Post. And I also was from Dundalk. And then he met me, and like, for whatever reason, and I grimace when he liked me, and like, I don't think he wanted to like me. I don't think he thought he was going to like me. And it was a little bit more, how did he treat your boyfriends?
Well, persona non grata for the most part. He just, it's like he saw right through them. They weren't there.
You know, see, I was very, I got the son treatment. I often wondered, he treated me like the son he never had. And I mean that in all the good militaristic ways, writer ways. Sometimes he'd give me a writer's tippy. I read your review. It was harsh shit. You know, so he would give me a little bit of that. But it was very, very, I was really rough around the edges. I had a child and I was a child myself. I mean, he was way into my life when I had a kid. I had a 2-year-old kid and he would always brush me up on making sure I was teaching my kid the right way. So he really like took me under his wing and gave me the tough military big brother, Uncle Phil type love. So like, I don't have any stories of doing anything untoward with your dad. I know he peed in an alley with Andre the Giant and he told me that, but that's about the best I can do with your dad's, you know, funny stories. I got nothing better than that. And he got in a fist fight with Earl Weaver on the lawn because Earl called his wife a name that Phil did not like. Phil was not much on the C word. And apparently Earl threw some bombs around from time to time after a couple pops. So I know a couple of those stories. But other than that, man, if he knew I had a crush on Susan, he never would have taken me to the game again.
Yeah, it's funny. I dated a lot of guys back in the day that were not into sports, believe it or not.
So they didn't care about him.
So it's like he couldn't connect on that level, I guess. And then my former spouse, when he came around, it was a different story because they really clicked because he's from Cleveland and he, you know, is a big sports fan and, you know, dog pound and all that kind of stuff. So, until we were ready to marry them, he really didn't much care for them.
I probably went to 150 hockey games with your father. Like, and we always went together. He always picked me up. He always insisted on driving like a madman on 295. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. And we always had great conversations in the car. It was just like this. It was so much more fun to go with him than it ever was alone. I went to games I didn't even care about because I just got in the car with him. Or he called me and say, kid, going to the Bullets game tonight. You want to endure it? And I'd say, Phil, I got this date with this girl from Essex. And, you know, he'd say, I understand. Well, I'll call you next week, you know. So he would always offer to pick me up and just go to games. And when I was free, I did. And I always had concerts or girls or parenting or like all like things. But we always went to games together. But the conversations we always had were about sport. He listened to sports radio. It's crazy. This is 1986, 7, 8, 9, 90, that whole time. So the Orioles being awful in 88, we were together in the car during all of that, April, May, June. We were always together in February, March, April, because we went to hockey games together a lot. And I guess during that era, you know, there wasn't a lot of sports media other than us. There was a newspaper, right? There was Vince Bagley on the news. And then sports radio was something I listened to. The Grease Man, you know, I listened to like,
so did I.
I listened to music. I was a B-4 means music and Brian and O'Brien in the morning. So I would do all this, you know, like Sarah Fleischer is a celebrity to me. Jeff Rimmer wasn't, right?
Evidently.
Right? Chris Emery was a celebrity to me. Like, you know, no offense, but Rex Barney, he was the guy at the ballpark. But Phil would he would listen to Phil Wood after the games. He would listen to post game. He was a real part of like what people were saying and callers. And he wrote the TV Repairman. So he was very up on what sports radio was saying. And here's the weirdest part, Michele. And then we're going to get to the kidney, but I got to tell some, because Phil's like a father to me and I love Phil. I always love Phil. So Phil, like never, ever, like wanted me to be in radio. And when I started doing sports radio, he really didn't like it. He didn't like Nasty Nestor. He didn't like the character. Like, he gave me tough love. I mean, like, not in a mean way, but just he did not approve of my radio show. Like, the first couple years, and he would come on and he would give me the hardest time because we did sports radio in the car together and we sat together at Caps games, and he always said, here, this is why I'm going to honor your father. Can't take these on a plane. He would bring scissors, and he would sit and he would clip the New York Daily News the press box at the Capitol Center. You know, did you ever go to a game with him?
Yes, I did. I loved hockey, and I wanted to see a live game. And one day after school, I finished my homework and he was going down and my mother was working at the club. And so I was like, Dad, I'm done my homework. Can I come to the game with you? And he's like, sure. So I got in the car, went to the game with him, and he sat me in the stands by myself because I couldn't get in the press box.
Right below the press box, though.
No, like halfway around the Cap Center. And so he came during, you know, after the first period and brought me a hot dog and stuff, and then stayed late after the game because he was writing and whatnot. And then we got home after midnight, and boy,
your first Caps game as a girl.
Yeah. Boy, did Tina read him the riot. You dug her on a solo night. You're getting her home at midnight. And I will never forget that, though.
But How old were you?
14, maybe.
13. So this is 79 or 80, somewhere?
Yeah, early high school, I guess, probably.
Wow.
That was and it changed my life. I have to say, my first hockey game, I was like, there's nothing like this.
I want to give the whole background. But first off, Michele Anthony's here. I call her Michele Jackman. We're kind of contemporaries, and Phil was my big brother, but you run the National Kidney Foundation Executive Director down in D.C. We're going to promote Santa. We're going to promote your golf tournament, but I want to promote your dad, my love for your dad and hockey. I'm watching Barry Trotz run around. Your dad and I used to chase Trotz around 30 years ago. So, but you know, like, you grew up, like, running around in diapers at spring training with Jim Palmer and Earl Weaver. Like, you, I've seen your pictures of little toehead girls on the beach in Miami at spring training, and your dad was covering the team when your dad took his job here at the Evening Sun, right? Like, so you were around baseball all the time, like, right?
Yeah, he was the beat writer back in, you know, when they came to town, I think almost immediately, but definitely during like 69 when they were.
Your family moved to Florida for a couple months every year.
Yeah. So we would, my mother would homeschool us, and we would go down to Florida for spring training, rent a house. And, you know, it was all we knew. And, oh, you know, the Jim Palmer story gets better.
You went over to that stadium many times, right? Bobby Maduro Stadium in Miami.
Yeah. Yep. And generally we would, you know, all the wives and kids would meet at the beach in the afternoon. We would, you know, do our homework. And
so you knew the Belanger kids and the Crowley kids like that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. They were all very, Etchebarren kids were some of our best friends. We were very close. My mother was very close to Aggie and Susie Palmer and, you know, all of them. But I was in a chicken fight and Jim Palmer was my partner. And this is a new wrinkle to the story that I think my father's making up.
What year is this?
Probably 70.
Okay. Maybe. So Jim Palmer and your family and his family are in Florida in the water, correct?
Correct.
And you're a little girl. You're 5 years old?
Yeah.
Okay.
And apparently my dad insists I peed on his shoulders during.
You pissed on Jim Palmer? No wonder he doesn't talk to me. I love this story.
I don't think it's true. You know, my father always said when I started to go into journalism in college, he's like, you know, 80% truth is good, you know, because you got to take some license and, you know, make the story more interesting, come up with composite characters. And so I always, you know, believed in the 80% rule. So I think my dad and the peeing on Jim Palmer's shoulders is that 20%.
Well, I guess bringing this thing full circle to hockey and you being a little girl, wasn't really a little girl going to Capitol Center, which, like, your mother's thinking, like, the fights at the Boston Gardens. The Capitol Center was a very benign It was a place a lot of young girls went and watched hockey and fell in love with the Caps. And like, it was even when the Flyers came or the Penguins back in the day, it was never like Madison Square Garden or Yankee Gate. It never had that vibe at a Caps game ever. It was always more of a refined crowd, quite frankly. It was more people that could afford the tickets, quite frankly.
Exactly. You can afford the tickets.
It was a Northern Virginia. Yeah, it was an executive crowd for the most part. But for you to fall in love with hockey, I mean, all these years later, you're talking 1979, 1980. When I think of you as an adult and getting to know you as adults, because we didn't really know each other at all as kids. You were off in college, and the first time I met you was in the eighth row at Brendan Byrne Arena with U2 tickets on the Joshua Tree tour, because Jackman's like, my daughter would like to go to that. You scored tickets? I'll get rid of two of them for you. This Us Two band, you know, the Bono kid. So anyway, that's where I met you in 1986. You were like a Hofstra student, and I knew your sister. I knew of you, but I don't think I had even ever met you. Your sister was always sort of buzzing around the house with Phil and Tina, and I'd always show up and think, man, if I were just 5 years older and Phil didn't know anything about me, I'd really have a chance with Susan. But I hung out with Phil far too much to have any, but nonetheless, I met you at that point, and I know you through social media. Like, you're a really big sports fan. For having been the daughter of a sports writer, but you're like a really big hockey fan, right? I mean, like the Caps are at your heart more so than the Nationals. And I know they've both won recently. Don't rub it in, but you sailed off the Orioles for like DC sports life. And you're like a part of that. You love DC sports.
I do. And I love the Orioles still, although, you know, it's a little hard. Challenging. It's a little challenging these days, but you know, I figure I have my AL team and my NL team, right? I can still have my AL team, and the Orioles are it. But my kids, you know, they were born in Northern Virginia and baseball was coming. We were so excited to be getting a team. So we belonged in this syndicate of people who bought season tickets. So we got 10 games a season or something. So, you know, from birth, my kids were really young going to Nats games. So
did they go to RFK? Do they remember going there?
Yeah. Katie remembers the Dippin' Dots at RFK. That's what got her to the games. We had to take turns getting her snacks, because otherwise you would see none of the game.
I'll let David Cope know that the Dippin' Dots are still remembered 15 years later. It is incredible they've been there 15 years and they've had all the success, right? And I got to bitching about Leonsis and the Caps this week and Trotz and watching him despite the 8-0 thing the other night. Just hockey people and your dad and that time in my life, being around the Capitals, and Ed Frankovic came on and we did 45 minutes. I haven't had him on in a long time. I haven't been to a Caps game since I walked off the ice in Las Vegas with Tony Robbins and Ovechkin with the cup. Literally. I've cold turkeyed it, but
yeah, maybe retire it there. You couldn't really get much higher than fucking up with the cup, right? And Ovechkin.
That's drop the mic. I mean, you're totally right about that. There's this thing where I really want Trotz to win and go to the Hall of Fame. Ed's like, he's going to the Hall of Fame. He's top five in wins and all of that. But Trotz is so special to me. And, in that period of time and the way hockey is, and I'll say this, and we'll get to the National Kidney Foundation, because I definitely want to do that with Michele. When we get talking about fathers and your dad and sports and hockey, I've been watching hockey because of my wife. My wife has become the sports fan in the family since the pandemic. So she's been watching golf, men's and women's. She's been watching tennis, French Open. We'll be watching Wimbledon next week, I'm sure. And even some baseball. But hockey, the Trotz thing and watching it, I put these hockey games on and I think to myself of that song, the good old hockey game. It's the best game you can name, right? And like, hockey's just so much the better sport than all the rest of them. And I say that as a passionate Trotz guy, but just watching the Islanders, watching sports again, hockey's so good.
It is so good. It just flies. It's so pure. It rarely stops. They fight it out. You know, they let them play for the most part. It's just such good. And I was just enthralled with the minute I saw it. It took me a little while to be able to follow the puck, not too long, but I was like, I can't see it. But then once you learn how to, you know, spot it and the movements and all of that kind of stuff, it's so exciting. And we, my mom and I were actually watching when the Caps were in the playoffs this year. And I said, oh, that's icing, you know, in the Caps. And she's like, what's icing? So I was explaining it to her. It's like, you know, when you cross two red lines and blah, 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 you know. But during a power play, what's a power play? And it was so funny because she doesn't sit around watching hockey games. And she goes, how do you know so much about hockey? And I said, Mom, it's my favorite sport. And I've been going to games since I was like, I don't know, 13 or something. And she's like, oh, okay.
Did you yell at Dad?
Yeah, since you yelled at Dad.
Michele Anthony's here. She used to be Michele Jackman. And I'll just say this, and I'll leave you with this. Your dad and I, our relationship, besides being sports writers and working at the same paper, there were a lot of people that worked there, but I spent a lot of time with him because we both loved hockey. And I was the only person in Baltimore that loved hockey. And that was literally our bond. Maybe the eternal bond for me will be watching him dance to Sweet Caroline at a Neil Diamond concert, but that came much later than the hockey part. But hockey brought he and I together. Well, and it's a bond you and I have, and it's not a bond I have with every, I met my wife at a hockey game, right? I met my wife at a Manchester Monarchs game, but hockey's like Rush. Not everybody gets it, but when they get it, they move closer to your heart. So speaking of heart, let's talk Kidney Foundation and what you do. You come on twice a year. We talk about your dad. We talk, tell sports stories. And I didn't even get to the Seattle Seahawks because we're not in season on that. I'm not going to let you ramble about that.
No, I don't want to ramble about them.
But you could ramble about that. But yeah, I know you, I'll call you in the fall. We'll ramble about that. We put Santa together. This has been so hard, the pandemic, on foundations, on charity, on everyone. I want to give you some oxygen to talk about the importance of the National Kidney Foundation. And I'm getting together with Dick Cass in a couple of weeks. He was a donor, saving lives, much like what my wife has been through. People donate kidneys every day, and they save lives every day.
Yeah. And I've got a couple of really good stories that have happened during COVID, good transplant stories. One is Josh Morgan. Do you remember he was a wide receiver for the Washington Redskins back when they were the Redskins? He is retired from the NFL now, but his brother was on dialysis and it happened fairly quickly. And he was, they decided that he needed a transplant. His kidney function reached the level. So their dad was stepping forward and getting tested to donate to him. And Josh was like, why do you want a 60-something-year-old kidney when you can have a 34-year-old kidney? So Josh stepped forward, tested, was a match, donated to his brother. And that was in the first month of COVID. So that was like end of March last year. So they're, you know, he just wants to be a blessing now and spread the word about organ donation. And
let's get him on, man, we'll have him tell a story before the next Sunday or whatnot.
Daniel and Josh, they're great guys.
It won't keep me from having you on, but you know, I mean, not in lieu of you, but you know, in addition to you.
In addition, okay. We'll have like a four-person screen.
Let's do that. That would be even more fun. Good.
That would be great. Okay, I'll suggest it to them.
Well, you got a golf tournament coming up next month, right?
We do. We are at Lansdowne, the golf club at Lansdowne, which, have you ever been there? It's a gorgeous resort in Leesburg, Virginia.
I walk golf courses. I don't play on them. It's in Leesburg. Okay. All right. I get out that way for concerts from time to time. You know this about me.
Yeah. Tally Ho in Leesburg, or where do you go?
Tally Ho, I've never been. The guys from Cheap Trick played last week. There is the Bodines are playing there. I got the date written down.
You should meet out there.
Bodines are playing there on the 28th of August, and I am sliding. I'm doing a Maryland crab cake tour that's going to be out in Antietam at Big Cork Vineyard out there. Beautiful, great vino. I'm hooking some vino up in a Tally Ho with Kurt from the Bodines, and we're going to sing songs like Paradise and Good Things all night long. So I promise you, I am coming to the Tally Ho Theater this summer before it's over with. Yes.
All right, I'll meet you there. Have you ever been to the Anthem in DC on the way?
I have been to the Anthem in DC. It's
that same kind of setup. It's like, you know, old theater.
Oh, I need vibe. Vibe me out for a Bodine show.
Balcony, you know, floor, you know, where you're smashed into each other, big stage. It's a really fun day.
Well, the Bodines are you know, with all due respect to Rush, Styx, all the bands I'm into, the Bodines are my sort of closet thing, that they're not the big band that I'm really into. So, yeah. So, you know, anytime Kurt shows up, he's threatened to come on the show. We're Facebook friends. I've invited him on. So this would be a big deal for me. If I could have a crab cake on the tour with Kurt Newman, it would, you know, and sing good things, I'd be all about it.
Back to the tournament. I completely forgot.
But yes, Leesburg tournament, July. Like Wayne's World.
We go off on our tangents so easily. We're big talkers.
I haven't even brought up the Seahawks.
That's the second time you haven't brought up the Seahawks. So Friday, July 16th, it's the NKF Konica Minolta Golf Classic. Benefiting the National Kidney Foundation. And it's a 10:30 shotgun captain's choice tournament. And really the incredible thing about our tournament that sets us apart is the top teams in our tournament go on, get invited to the national finals at Pebble Beach. So it's a way to walk onto Pebble Beach, which is really amazing. So, you know, come visit us. NKFGolfClassic.com is where you can find us. And we still are accepting foursomes. July 16th, join us, support the Kidney Foundation.
All right, July 16th, I think the Padres are playing your Nationals that weekend. The Orioles will still be in last place. It's been tough, Michele. The Oriole thing here, you know, I mean, when is Sante coming back to, we had Rebecca on, you know, recently, talking Visionary Arts. They had an incredible guest. Wow. I mean, like one of the best guests we've ever had on the program, a musician talking about converting KKK members and taking their robes. Like, it's the most unbelievable segment we've ever done on Baltimore Positive. And they were doing an event about positivity and bringing people together at the Visionary Arts. You've brought people together. Sante's been at Visionary Arts forever. COVID's wiped out all sorts of things. Please tell me we're bringing Sante back so I can go eat and be inspired by your folks at the National Kidney Foundation.
Yeah. So this year in March, Sante was virtual. But I have every reason to believe it's coming back in March of 2020.
Give me a date. I got to put that in my calendar so I'm not doing something foolish.
Maybe you can judge and we can get some of that yummy panna cotta that we flipped out for.
I'm telling you what, I'm going to bring her in on catering one night. I mean, she made a panna. You're still talking about this panna cotta 3 years
We're
later.
We're still talking about
And you know what's weird is like I've been a place or two and saw panna cotta and I'm like, I'll order it. And it's same thing as probably ordering a crab cake in Leesburg. You just don't do it. You're not in Maryland. You don't order a crab cake. You know, panna cotta can only happen at Sante, at the Visionary Arts Museum, at the National Kidney Foundation event. I hope you guys bring this back. I want to be a part of it. I know it's so important in fundraising and knowing and education and awareness, all the things we try to bring to people. Where's all that been in the last year and a half? I mean, people are, I mean, especially in the early part of COVID, I would think this has been a very, very difficult thing medically all the way around for donors and finding donors, even though we had a miracle story that you're telling. I'm sure it's been difficult.
Yeah, I mean, at the very beginning of COVID, just for a very brief time, they kind of shut down living donor transplants because of, you know, shortage of operating rooms and PPE and for the safety of living donors, because we didn't know anything at the beginning of COVID. So it was just, but then, you know, transplants came back. But one of the big issues is that kidney patients, like dialysis patients, have a lot of comorbidities. They have, you know, they might have high blood pressure, diabetes. Those are the leading causes of kidney failure. So they are, you know, if we really had to protect them from COVID, because they would be extremely sick if they caught COVID, more likely to be, you know, ventilated and hospitalized and everything else. So
I don't remember my wife was neutropenic and fighting and in the fight and just the, you know, I mean, she had a cheesecake that put her in the emergency and put her in a coma for 3 days, literally, like crazy things that make people sick of germs. I mean,
right.
You know, right. Every part I'm watching, you know, and you know, my love for your sister, but watching what she battled out in LA for every nurse, every doctor, every frontline worker a year and a half ago. By the way, I have this. You see this? I put this up for Susan in case she sees it. This was the hospital and the heart on the hospital. This was during COVID last year.
Yeah, that was pretty amazing. But one of the post-transplant, here's another problem that we're having, is you may have heard this, but kidney patients who are immunosuppressed, you know, they take medication so that their body doesn't reject the new kidney. So they're immunosuppressed.
Very familiar with that with my wife as well. She had a thing called graft versus host disease.
There you go. So she might be in the same boat. I hope not. But a lot of patients have taken the vaccine and the antibodies are not there. The antibodies aren't forming. So there's a study that's starting on that. And, you know, there's some talk of a third vaccine is, you know,
well, the vaccine doesn't work because your immune system isn't ready for a vaccine. My wife had that issue where my wife, after both transplants, had to get all of her vaccinations again. So I hear these anti-vax people and these idiots all along the world, right? But my wife had to wait to get the vaccinations. She was exposed to all of those things as an infant, but as a walking 45-year-old bald woman, I witnessed all of that. So when people start talking about an immune system and immune suppression and the people first in line to get the shots, you know, that needed to be protected, it's so, so important. And everyone waiting for a kidney is, you know, sick, very sick.
Yeah. And we really advocated, you know, we reached out to the governors of every state and to the mayor of DC really to prioritize kidney patients because initially they weren't.
Wow.
But they kept, you know, everything has been fluid. It's understandable as we learned more and more. So we were successful in getting them added to like the 1B list pretty early on, you know, earlier in the year. So that was great. So patients were able to start getting their vaccines. And definitely the transplant surgeons were advocating for them getting vaccines before they were transplanted for the reason I just stated. So it's been, you know, it's been a challenging year. It's been a challenging fundraising year, definitely. But we have pivoted in our events and our programs and been pretty successful. I mean, one of the good things about going virtual with programs is that, you know, patients could stay home and be safe. And so we've seen our numbers go up. We have a program called the Big Ask, the Big Give, which is about, you know, helping them to find a living donor. First Steps to Transplant is another program. But it allows us to cross state lines. It allows us to reach so many more people. We can get the best experts on, and they don't have to travel anywhere. So, you know, we've looked on the bright side and we've had a lot of wonderful corporate support. And really I have to thank, you know, a few people that, and companies who I really relied on and said, we need you now more than ever. It is a rough year for kidney patients. And they really stepped up and supported. So, you know, I'm really, really grateful to them.
If you know anybody in your life that's had a kidney transplant or been a donor or been involved in any way with kidney struggles, dialysis, these things, you need someone like the National Kidney Foundation. And my lifer friend, Michele Jackman Anthony, she's the executive director of the National Kidney Foundation. But more than that, the daughter of Phil Jackman, who was sort of a father to me. And, you know, yeah, I had to ask you about the boyfriends and stuff back in the day because he was tough on me and I didn't date any of y'all.
I've got a good story. He's mellowed. He's mellowed since I brought guys home. My daughter, I don't know if you know this, is getting married in August. Her now betrothed, who was her boyfriend, started coming around early, like last summer. He would come like every week or every other week to come see my parents. So, you know, it was great. But he has not been around the past couple of months, just different things have happened, like planning a wedding. And we brought him on Father's Day. And when my dad saw him, he's like, hey, it's the pizza boys back. So he was so excited. I was like, you know, if he gave you a nickname, he loves you. Because otherwise he wouldn't even bother with you. Because that's, I know that's how he is.
Me any nickname and he hated Nasty Nestor. He hated everything about it. When he would come in the studio, he would play that other role of tough guy authority. Like I have hours of tapes of he and I, and he early on, he was really tough on me. Now I mellowed a little bit once, like it worked. This nasty thing. This is a mistake. And then it caught on. He's like, all right, maybe they wanted some entertainment. You know, so.
Yeah, he will. He'll admit when he's wrong.
Oh no, never wrong. Mistaken. Michele, love you, appreciate you. Love to mom, dad, sisters, you know, grandkids, everybody over there. We'll get together soon. We'll get a ball game in, and we'll get
a plan now to get together this summer, which is great.
Well, I'm doing this crab cake tour. You know, you're always welcome to meet me somewhere on the Beltway down there for, I always say, like, I've had a bunch of the Beltway politicos on. Michael Steele's been on, and Donna Edwards.
I love Michael Steele. I have the biggest crush on him.
Well, we'll come have a crab cake with us, because he's joining me on it for a crab cake in August. So I'll let you know. It's going to be down.
Let me know where Michael Steele's going to be. I'll start
Bowie, Laurel, Rockville, someplace. I said to him, and I've said this to everybody, and you know this because you grew up in the city, right? So the notion that a guy like me from Dundalk would ever think, I really want to get a good crab cake. I'll go to DC. Like, said no one ever. Like, ever, right? I'm going to go to Bowie to get a good crab cake, or Laurel, or Rockville, or Greenbelt, or National Harbor, or Potomac. You know, they probably put parsley in it or something. I would just say, but every crab person tells me this, like people that harvest out of the bay, the really expensive crab meat, the $50 a pound jumbo that comes from Maryland, that it is the fufu shishi Washington restaurants that prepare said crab cake in a traditional style, upcharge for it because it's DC pricing. But apparently you can get a really good crab cake in DC, apparently, from what I understand.
Well, I am a huge, huge crab cake aficionado, so I will.
Why come to you? Because you come from East Palmer, huh?
Yep. Hamilton, born and raised myself.
Tough. Once peed on Jim Palmer, according to legend.
Yeah, who peed on Jim Palmer? Exactly.
I made her say it again. I love it.
I don't believe him. I think he made that up.
All right, I gotta go. I'm blushing now. All right, support the National Kidney Foundation. Tell everybody how to support you, real quick.
NKFBoneplastic.com, kidneywdc.org.
All right, I'll send out a tweet and a link and all that stuff. Take care of your family. Happy Father's Day to Phil, Felipe, King Phil, as we called him, and all the other fathers out there, including me, who got. Somebody looked at me. I was
Happy
at a state
Father's
fair.
You as well.
I was at a state fair with my wife getting chicken and waffles, as I do on Father's Day. We went to see Cheap Trick down at Ramsey, but we were over in state fair, and a server walks by me, and I got the mask on. You know, I'm like all masked up, right? And the server says, Happy Father's Day to me. And I'm like, I'm almost offended that I look old enough to be a father. You know what I mean? Like, so like, how do you know I'm a father? Like, you know, like, come on, don't weigh all that heavy on me. But my son's doing well too, and he wished me Happy Father's Day. And at some point, I don't know, we'll get some pie together or something. Michele Jackman Anthony, the National Kidney Foundation, Sante's around the corner, the golf tournament. Give, help, sign up, donate, be good about things, help people. We've had a freaking plague. It's been hard enough. I am Nestor. We are WNST, Towson, Baltimore. We call ourselves BaltimorePositive.com.